You are listening to the Cycling Podcast at Our Giro d'Italia, brought to you by iWalkUp, flexible loans built for small businesses. Today, we are in Corvara in Badia.
Cozze, citele, cozze, cozze, piscine, non spigudeci cora, non spigudeci cora.
Where are we, Lionel?
We are in Corvara in Badia. This is definitely the Dolomites, right, Daniel?
Correct, but it's Badia, not Badia. Oh. But anyway, we're in the Dolomites.
I mean, how do you know that? For those of us,
it's very difficult. Actually, it's something you just learn.
We're in the Dolomiti, no?
Yes, but that wasn't what we were. That wasn't the point we were making. Anyway, Richard, just crack on.
Correcting you there.
You just put your head down and buffalo through the episode.
What have we got coming up tonight, Lionel?
Well, it's appropriate that we're in the Dolomites because this is our visual Giro episode. Obviously, the Dolomites are very photogenic, aren't they? And Corvara is particularly so. Do you remember, Daniel, we were there in 2016 when Esteban Chavez won and the finish line was just across, you know, right across the road, and right in the background, straight through the finish, was pretty much the stereotypical Dolomite shot, wasn't it? I mean, I managed to get a good photo of that on my phone.
Yes, napalm. And I had one shot, so we were going to limit ourselves. I was going to limit myself to one Dolomite stage in our Giro because we're trying to sort of fit it in with what would have been the 2020 Giro route. There was only one real Dolomite stage on that. One Dolomite stage on our Giro. So I decided to go for this sequence of climbs. Are we going to get onto that? Are we going to get onto that later, or will you indulge me now?
Let's do it. I mean, it's a brutal stage, isn't it? Run us through what we're going over.
Well, before we get to the climbs, we're going to go up the valley towards Longarone, where we've been through there before, napalm, and I think we've spoken before about the disaster in 1963. The Vaillant Dam collapsed, and it wiped out two villages at the bottom of the mountain there. Over 2,000 people died. One of the most famous disasters in Italian history. Again, we've spoken quite a lot about these sort of disasters that have marked the recent history of Italy over the course of our Giro, and you know, the rebuilding operation that took place after each of those. And this is another very famous one. So we go to Longarone, then we turn left and we got the Forcella Staulanza, which is a bit of a gateway to the Dolomites. And then we're going over the Fedaia, also known as the Marmolada. The Marmolada is the highest mountain in the Dolomites, and the Fedaia is kind of the pass that goes up the side of it. Not the most beautiful of the Dolomite passes, but for my money, the most formidable Dolomite climb, the most notorious, the Dolomite climb where most hopes and dreams have been shattered. There's a particular stretch, Malga Charpela, which is very famous, sort of halfway up there. It's very steep and a real brute. And then the Passo Sella, the road that goes to the Passo Sella and Passo Pordoi is the same one, and then they fork, so they're kind of like the Siamese twins of the Dolomites. I prefer the Sella, so we're going to turn, I think, left to the Sella rather than the Pordoi. And then we're going to go over the Passo Gardena, which is another absolute showstopper of a climb in terms of just the views and the visual beauty of it, the quintessential Dolomite landscape up there on the Gardena.
And just clear this up, the Marmolada is the name of the mountain, but Fedaia is the name of the pass, is that right?
Correct.
Oh, I've learned something about the Dolomites in all my years of getting the Dolomites wrong.
There's a famous story in 1998, I think Marco Pantani was going up the Fedaia for the first time, and about halfway up the climb, on the hardest part where, you know, 90% of the field had already been blown away, he turned to his domestique Roberto Conti and said, "When does the Marmolada start?" And yeah, they'd done about 10 kilometres of the Fedaia / Marmolada already.
That is exactly the sort of thing that would happen to me. Now, no surprise that on our Giro, riding on the RGT platform, we're going to be riding the Fedaia. It looks like a brute. Let's hear one of us. I don't know who we're going to hear from on the course today. Who's drawing the shortest straw?
We're both riding, aren't we, Lionel? We're both committed to this one.
Yeah, but I'll be doing that lovely downhill bit where you don't have to pedal before we start climbing.
So here's
again
the sound of Lionel dropping like a stone. At stage 13 done, I am a couple of days behind off the back. But stage 13 done, 37.5 kilometres, 876 metres of climbing. I was riding for a bit, well, on the course at the same time as Dan Smith from our sponsors Iwoka. Hi Dan, good luck, he's playing catch up too. Lionel Birnie was out on the course, well, obviously focusing again after his abandonment yesterday on the Inter Giro competition. My average power today, for those interested in that kind of thing, 223 watts. And I will be releasing all my power files from Our Giro at the end of the race, probably through Gazzetta dello Sport, I think, just so that people can see and scrutinise those figures for themselves in the interests of full transparency.
You are listening to the Cycling Podcast at Our Giro d'Italia, brought to you by Iwoka, flexible loans built for small businesses. iwoca.co.uk.
Well, our title sponsors are Iwoka, aren't they, Richard? And you can find out all about Iwoka at iwoka.co.uk. They've just been awarded accreditation by the British Business Bank to, well, they've got Sybil status. What does Sybil stand for, Richard?
Why and Richard and not Daniel as well?
Well, we know Daniel can't remember the simplest of messages, so I'm hoping that we can rely on you.
He's full with all these foreign languages. He can't remember basic things like a Sybil. What's a Sybil? A Sybil is the Coronavirus Business Interruption Loan Scheme, of course.
Well, I did know, actually, Richard, what it was, because I've been doing my research. It was set up by the government to help small businesses that have been impacted by the coronavirus crisis. It's obviously been a very worrying time for small businesses, and Iwoka will be lending money to get small businesses starting again as the economy sort of, you know, comes back into action. Let's hear from a customer who chose Iwoka in slightly different circumstances about why he chose to borrow some funds from Iwoka for his small business.
I'm Patrick Healy, and I'm the owner of Peak Ascent Cycles, which is a bike shop based in the Peak District. The bike shop is pretty much, we're getting towards a one-stop shop for bikes, so anything from servicing, maintenance, parts and accessories to bikes themselves. Always a bit of free advice on hand as well for those that are looking for it. The bike business can be very seasonal. We've hit the ground running, so the big challenge I had was obviously expanding the range due to public demand, but more importantly, just having that cash flow to be able to bring in new stock. And that's where Iwoka sort of ticked all the boxes for me. I tend to look for something with a bit of soul, if that makes sense. Something that understands my needs. I can get to talk to somebody who's real and really get a flavour for what I'm entering into and how it's going to work for me going forward. I sort of started with an apply online, but very quickly I got somebody to talk to. It certainly made the process itself even simpler than had it, you know, just been the online, which again is a really straightforward process. And then everything after that was really quick. I was surprised how quick and easy it was, if I'm honest. Well, our business rocks, basically. It's gone from being a bike shop to proper little community hub, really. We've even gone down the route of fixing kids' prams, multi-ability scooters, somewhere to just pop in when it's cold outside and talk about the good old days on the old-school bikes and where they got the first one from. But, yeah, every day is different. It's amazing.
I'm a record. I remember.
Lucas Postelberger!
I still have goosebumps, yeah.
Was it a plan or was it instinct?
No, I mean, the plan was to ride for Sam. I have not seen the footage on the TV, so I don't know what happened then. Normally he should do the second last man as a lead out, so something happened. I hear Sam shouting in the radio, go, 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 and then it was clear. So our big goal was to get one stage win in these 3 weeks, yeah, after Leopold not being here. So we achieved it on the first day, though.
Well, we were taken back there to Sardinia in 2017, weren't we? And the start of the Giro. And a huge surprise when Lucas Postelberger clipped off the front and won the stage and took the first pink jersey.
I thought you were going to say a huge buffet there, because it was a huge buffet and it was spectacular and it was sunlit and it was, you know, liberally lubricated with local wine.
It was.
Drink responsibly, everyone. We should remind everyone to drink responsibly.
It was fantastic. And I remember it being notable also for the fact that Lucas Postelberger was the first Panini sticker that you pulled out your packet, wasn't he?
I was just going to say, do you remember the Nostradamus quality that I bestowed on the Panini stickers? I opened the stickers after the stage had happened, and Postelberger was the first sticker out. And so he kind of reverse predicted the stage win. If I'd opened it 3 or 4 hours before, it would have been sort of, I don't know, some kind of medieval witchcraft at work.
You should become an astronomer, Lionel.
Oh, excellent. But Postelberger were one of these riders who we didn't know an awful lot about and you know, instantly found quite endearing. He was great in his press conference and a great winner and first pink jersey in that Giro, and kind of suitable to set us up for the stage, because there was a real thrill in him wearing pink. He had his mother was there with her dog. She was in her camper van. They were all decked out in pink over certainly the next day. It really meant something to him to wear the pink jersey. And we're going to be talking about the colour pink a little bit later in this episode, which is all about the visual Giro. And before we get onto what we're calling our pink package, we'll hear from the photographer, Graham Watson, a real stalwart of professional cycling for many years until he suddenly just disappeared from the sport.
Well, yeah, that was the first thing I asked him about, how he was enjoying retirement in New Zealand. And it was a couple of years ago that he didn't tell anyone that he was going to retire after the Tour Down Under that year and just say farewell to professional cycling, which he'd been working in since the early 80s. And his first experiences at the Giro were in the 80s. And, as he says in this sequence that we're going to hear from Graham Watson, the Giro was his favourite race to cover, to photograph. He enjoyed the food and the wine as well, I'm sure, because Italy is a fantastic country to travel around. But you're right, there's something, isn't there, beguiling about the colour pink, the contrast of the beaches and seaside with the Dolomites. You know, that you can kind of conjure in your mind sort of 6 or 7 stereotypical Giro d'Italia images in a way that I don't really feel I can do the equivalent for the Tour de France. But anyway, here's Graham Watson talking
Sorry, Lionel. I mean, worth saying just a little bit about Graham Watson, isn't it? I mean, because I think for us, especially Lionel, I'm not sure about you, Daniel, but for us getting into cycling in the 80s, when you were just a nipper, Daniel, it was Graham Watson who provided a visual introduction through his photography. And you know, the magazines at the time and books that were covering the sport all featured the work of Graham Watson. And you know, when I think about the standout images from that period, I think of, you know, Le Monde and Eno on Alpe d'Huez, for example, in 86, and Graham Watson's great set of photographs from that day, and very vivid in their colour, and for me really captured the glamour and the exoticism of the sport very effectively, Graham Watson.
Yeah, I suppose Winning Magazine, Winning Bicycle Racing Illustrated, was the big vehicle for Graham's work in those years, wasn't it? And that's where I first discovered it, and then bought books, which I've actually got on my desk in front of me here. One, Visions of Cycling, you know, kind of the blueprint for how cycling looked in still images for, you know, for a long time, certainly if you were following the sport from the UK. And I suppose, whenever I saw Graham in Italy, whenever I was at the Giro, you know, he struck up a very good friendship with Roberto Bettini, an Italian photographer, and they kind of were a bit of a double act, I think, sort of, you know, worked their way around Italy together, certainly very good friends. And you know, Graham kind of, you know, certainly enjoyed traveling around the country, as we'll hear now.
When I planned the retirement from a long way back, and you know, I just carried it through. My whole plan went through quite well, and I ended up down here. And because of the TV coverage, because of the internet, I just keep in touch. I do everything except take pictures of a bike race. I'm still a fan. I'm still observing my favorite cyclists and my favorite races. And sometimes I manage to observe my old colleagues working on motorbikes. So, no, I don't miss it. There's too much going on down here for me. There's a bit of an outdoor life, lots of walking, hiking, cycling, loads of adventures to do. So, I stopped at 60 to try and give myself a chance to actually pursue some of that rather than leave it until too late. I had to do the Tour down there because of contractual reasons. I was their race photographer. And by doing it, of course, still nobody knew what I was doing. And Adelaide's about a three-hour flight away from New Zealand. So I just walked away from it, and that was it. And told nobody. It's the way to go. Yeah, I mean, I did the Tour in increasing sort of increments from about 1978 onwards. And I then did the Vuelta in 1985 because there was a new magazine that began in Spain, and which I was pretty much involved with. And then logically after 85 in the Tour of Spain, I had to go to Italy in 86 to see what it was all about. And that started like a 30-year kind of an adventure with the Tour of Italy. But the time I'd done the Giro in 86, I'd also done Milan-San Remo two or three times and the Tour of Lombardy two or three times. So Italy wasn't a strange country to me, but it was still amazing how much the vibe, the popularity, the noise, the suspense, if you like, the excitement in the streets whenever the Giro was coming into town. And especially in those days, when I went to see the Giro the first time, they had an Italian in a pink jersey, which is what Italians love. And I was struck by just the atmosphere, just the race itself. There was just so much going on around it. It wasn't just the bike race. It was I sort of felt the passion, I think, of the Italian people towards their national tour. And with that being funny, the Italians don't need an excuse to take a day off work. And what you do find is that not only does the race go through all these, you know, cluttered villages and towns on the way, when they go into the mountains, Italians take a day off work and they travel up from Milan or from Bolzano or from even inland from Venice to see the race because it means so much to them. And you know, they just take the day off work and nobody really cares. Well, they didn't care back then. Yeah, there's nothing more fantastic than a foreign challenger to an Italian race leader. And in this case, Roche, it was a pre-planned tactic. I think he had two mates on the team, Chiappucci and Eddie Shepherds. And they planned this stage, which was, I think it was the stage in Zapata in the Dolomites. And they knew what they were doing. And he knew Visentini had made a big effort, I think, the day before in an uphill time trial in San Marino. And Roche knew exactly what he was doing. He attacked hard on that stage. He had Chiappucci with him in this big escape, and Visentini didn't know what to do. He was legless. But what I did love was how Roche had pre-planned it and was absolutely ruthless. I mean, absolutely ruthless person on a bicycle. And he kind of let me. I was actually traveling with the British journalist John Wilcoxon back then, and somehow the two of us managed to sort of like embed ourselves unofficially with Roche's little mini team within a team. And for a couple of nights, we were actually in his room with him having scraps of pizza and everything else while the soigneur did his job. And the mechanic was actually in the room repairing or servicing Stephen's bike because they didn't trust anybody else to do it. And it was an unprecedented situation for me to be in a rider's room, but also to hear his explanation of how he was going to, you know, kick Visentini's ass the next day and the day after the day. And just continually going to attack Visentini until he made it clear that Roche was the leader of the Carrera team and Visentini wasn't. Back then, I was only about 7 years into my career, so I didn't actually understand everything I was seeing. But I think there was one time when I did see Boisfava, you know, somehow come alongside Roche's little group on the Marmolada climb and just lay into him and banging on the panels of his driver's door. But Roche just ignored him. Just ignored him, and you know, he just said, "The legs will do the talking. I'm going to win the Giro." And eventually, these Italians on the team—when I say Italians, the team management—just backed down. And of course, Visentini also threw in the towel as well. He didn't even finish that Giro. He went home, I think about 3 days to go. He was just so disgusted that nobody would support him. There was lots of boos and hisses, and there were people spitting. A few idiots throwing, you know, like glass of beer at Roche and Robert Miller on these big climbs in the Dolomites. But it wasn't quite as charged as people make out. It was. I also discovered in hindsight, many years later, that actually Visentini wasn't that popular. He comes from a very, very wealthy family and was basically cycling because it was fun to do. It was a fun thing to do. And so Roche became very popular in the last week of that Giro because he'd taken on an Italian in Italy and he'd let his legs do the talking. I mean, he was very careful what he said on camera to the media. He just literally let his legs do the talking. And, you know, he kept out of trouble. And I think the Tifosi really respected him because of that. He was just simply the better cyclist. I think it's important to remember that 35 years later, it's the one Giro d'Italia they still talk about. They don't talk about a Tour of Italy of 10 years ago, 20 years ago. They talk about this one of 1987, which is 35 years back. And that's how much I realise now how important that Giro was, both back then and also now in the bigger history of the race. Yeah, I mean certainly there was a huge difference between when Roche or even Fignon won in '89. And then when Indurain won in 92, 93. But there was still, you know, he still had to do an awful lot of work to beat the Italians. He was up against some of the best climbers in Italian cycling history. I mean, short of Pantani, who kind of started winning in 94. I mean, he had some mighty people to go against, like Chioccioli, loads of people. I mean, I can't remember all their names now, but they were the best of the best back then. In fact, Indurain, the first Giro he won was 92, and I think he'd got there. He'd won the Tour de France already in 91, and they knew how good a time trialist he was. So he won a time trial, I think, in the first few days of the 92 Giro, and wore the pink jersey for the rest of the race, which actually annoyed a lot of people because it was too easy for him. But nevertheless, he carried that jersey all the way through to into the mountains, the Dolomites and Alps, and he never wavered. He beat off all the many, many attacks against him. And again, in a lot of respect, I think they knew a big champion was in their presence, a campionismo was in their presence, more than when Stephen Roach won the race. When Stephen won the race, it wasn't unexpected, but he hadn't won the Tour yet. He wasn't like a well-known champion, whereas Indurain was. And I think they were probably quite scared of him. And secondly, he won very nicely. The team, which was already Benesto, but the team let other riders win. They weren't greedy, and that's very important. When you're the strongest guy in the race, in a foreign race, you should always let the locals win a little bit. And Benesto were very clever, very careful to make sure the locals won quite a bit. In the Tour of Italy, I had not seen anything like Pantani. The way he was revered. He was God. He was beyond God. He was just like the Tifosi had just loved, and he was actually very typical of a lot of Italian men. He was very small, quite short. He was bald, and he fitted into so many people's sense of affections, if you like. And he was very much, just loved and adored, quite simply. I mean, Italy went mad for him. I think TV even started coming on air about half an hour early because of him, which was quite a big step. But it's curious to look back and see that the 98 Giro, he didn't win a single stage. Whereas the 99 Giro, he won four stages and probably would have won a fifth if he hadn't been thrown out of the race on the very last mountain stage. He absolutely dominated the 99 Giro. He just ate everybody up. He won every uphill stage, I think it was, until they threw him out of the race.
Eccolo, tifo da stadio qui ad Europa.
Un tifo da stadio calcistico. Pantani non si rialza, non molla sino al traguardo e poi si concede l'alzata.
He was phenomenal to watch. He was combative. He was extremely competitive with Laurent Jalabert, who was in the race and who led the Tour of Italy for about a week and actually looked likely to win it. And they went head-to-head so many times, and only finally when they got into the big mountains was Jalabert pushed back out of the top five places. Apart from the fact that he got kicked out on that penultimate stage, it was such a dominating performance that whatever he did in 98 is almost forgotten. He's such a good climber, but he had such atrocious bad luck during the years between 94 and 98 that he was always crashing. He had some really horrible crashes, actually a career threatening crash, I think. And eventually, you want him to get his act together and prove that he could win a race overall. And when he did, everybody was so excited. And as a photographer, Pantani was one of those climbers that stares. If you imagine I'm sitting on the back of a motorbike looking backwards at my subjects as they're pedaling away behind me. And Pantani is one of these climbers that climbed and was able to stare straight ahead of him. He wasn't one of these climbers that pedaled and looked at the ground in front of him. And I won't mention names, but Pantani would ride his bicycle and he would just look straight ahead of him. And if he happened to be looking through your lens, it was quite a tingling sensation to see this legend performing in front of you. My motorbike driver, who's Italian, actually, he just sort of casually mentioned, he said, there's a problem at Pantani's hotel. And it was actually one of the rare mornings when I hadn't had a hangover. His whole team, his soigneurs and mechanics, were crying in a car park. They just couldn't believe that he'd been thrown out. The crime to them was not he'd been caught. It was the fact they were dethroning the great Marco Pantani. It shouldn't happen. I took off and did my normal day as always and had quite a good time. And I was shocked at the spectators on the Motorola, which is they're all there for Pantani, only for Pantani. Tens of thousands of them, and they were just, their faces just, they were distraught, they were crying, they just couldn't believe, they'd been up there all night, they'd camped there since the day before, and this was probably the toughest climb of the whole race, and their hero wasn't going to show up, so very strange atmosphere. Mm-hmm. 2008's got a lot of nice things going for it. The basics are that Contador won it, and this is the year, and Contador was already, a Tour de France winner. So he was a little bit like in Durand in 1992 in that he was a big champion, legendary champion, coming to the Tour of Italy for the first time, and people only expected him to win. There was no question of him coming fifth or sixth. He was going to come first, second or third, and most likely he was going to win. And the prelims to this was, of course, Astana, who is riding for, weren't allowed to ride the Tour that year, nor Paris-Nice. So, and they weren't meant to be riding the Tour of Italy either, but they somehow there was a business deal put together, I think off the record or unofficially, whereby Astana had to pay their way into the Tour of Italy that year in 2008. And they paid a lot of money, an awful lot of money, I think. And because of that, they decided to send their best team, which was really Contador, supported by Levi Leipheimer and Andreas Klode, and plus a bunch of Spanish people to particularly look after Contador. So they went there determined to win, but Contador had just come straight from the beach. He'd taken the time off. He hadn't trained. He figured that the season was almost lost because they weren't riding the Tour. And he was obviously planning to ride the Tour of Spain towards the end of the year. But no, they sent him to the Giro, and he won. He didn't win a single stage, very much like Pantani in 98. But he won the race, and he won it very convincingly. And he became a much bigger champion than before the Giro was ridden. It was phenomenal. Several things stand out. The most important thing to mention, first of all, is on stage four, Mark Cavendish won his first ever Giro stage, his first ever Grand Tour stage.
He's ahead of the Ciclamino jersey, is he? It's Cavendish!
And it was a phenomenal thing happening because Bradley Wiggins was one of his teammates, as was Tony Martin. And it wasn't really a Cavendish sort of finish. It went along we were down at the, not the heel of Italy, like the instep, if you like, of the foot. And there was a seaside resort called Catanzaro. And the race came along the coast, turned left into town, went on a little circuit, which included a cobbled hill, and it came back down a cobbled hill, and then finished down in the town. And it's very un-Cavendish in terms of topography and also the road surface. And he beat people like Paolo Bettini and Daniele Benatti. It was phenomenal what he pulled off, and that was his first ever win. And I was there when he stopped, and when Wiggins stopped about 30 seconds later, and just grabbed Cavendish and just gave him a great big hug, and they just burst into tears, both of them. They couldn't believe what they'd achieved for Mark that day. It was fantastic to see, especially as a British guy. You know, you don't get many British stage wins in the Giro, and here was this guy who you knew was very, very good, and he pulled off a stage win I thought was impossible for him. The other stage that year was they went up a thing called Plan de Coronis, which is there was a ski resort in the Dolomites near a town called Brunico, I think, and the organisation locally had laid a very thin tarmac over the hillside where people normally ski down, and turned it into a brutal hill climb, and it was high risk stuff. It was one of the many things the Giro has done over the years, which is to be a little bit courageous, yes, but almost reckless. And this time they pulled it off, this really incredible hill climb for about, I think it was about 15 kilometers long. It was brutal and it was spectacular. And they had all these chairlifts, cable cars going up the mountain, which would normally carry skiers. And they were carrying tens of thousands of Italian fans, or just cycling fans up there to watch this historical time trial. The Dutch love sport. Well, everybody loves sport, but the Dutch especially like sport of all kinds. And, you know, cycling is in their blood, it's in their heritage, in their history. And the Giro starting in Amsterdam, you know. And, I mean, for us it was fantastic because Bradley Wiggins won the first stage. And there were 10 deep people where they were absolutely crazy just for a time. The Dutch hate time trials, but they turned out in force with this guy or for these guys that day. And it was the first, you know, I've been to Athens, and Nice, like you say, is Italy. This is the first real foreign start of a modern tour of Italy. And the tour of Italy organised were blown away by the reception they got up there in Amsterdam. And also in the following few days, around, I think, Utrecht we went to and somewhere else. It was it really opened their eyes and actually led to the next few years of being a foreign start every 2 years. And also they made an awful lot of money off the town where they started from. So it became very attractive in both directions. Well, it started with a bang in the Netherlands. You know, apart from Wiggins winning this first stage time trial, it was lots of crashes in the first 2 days, absolutely littered the roads with broken bikes and broken bodies. And the race got better and better every day. Went back to Italy, went a wonderful team time trial. But then they rode this stage seven, went over the white roads of Tuscany for the first time. And again, it goes back to the Tour of Italy being a little bit reckless because it poured with rain that day. Absolutely poured and poured and poured with rain. And it turned these already dangerous roads into mud. And of course, I was loving it as a photographer. You know, I'd like every day to be like that. It was like a good Paris-Roubaix in the sense that it was wet and muddy. And even then it didn't stop. It just went on day after day of bad weather. It became a challenge physically for the cyclists, which meant for the photographers, it became a real delight to photograph these cyclists, you know, really suffering in the weather. If you work from the end of the Tour of Italy to the beginning, I chose that Tour of Italy because of the start. It was to be in Ireland and see how much better than Amsterdam they were, how much better than Herning and Denmark they were.
It's going to go all the way. Kittel, who takes it,
didn't. It was fantastic. I think also, you know, we're physically close enough to the island of Ireland to make them feel like they're one of us or we're one of them sometimes. And so it was almost as good as a British start might be with the Tour of Italy. It was fantastic, especially if you're of a certain age whereby you went to see the old Nissan Classic in the mid-1980s, because these guys are a totally different organisation, a totally different part of the world. But, I mean, tens of thousands of people came out to watch the race in pretty bad weather. And instead of wearing the green flags you saw during the Kelly and Roche years and banners saying Kelly and Roche, everybody was wearing pink scarves or waving pink flags and cheering for the Giro instead of Kelly and Roche. It was an amazing 3 days. I mean, it hasn't been bettered, I know that. this afternoon I was trying to think of one way of describing the Giro, several ways. One is if you think the best things about the Tour de France, and then you think the best things of the Tour of Spain, and add those to what you think about the Tour de France, and then you look at the Giro d'Italia, and it trumps those two races put together in all ways. And there's also things like because of the unmaintained roads and overused roads, you know, every time you go around a corner, something surprising is going to happen or could happen. There's no such thing as an ordinary day in the Tour of Italy. It's just incredible how many things have happened, mainly good, but sometimes bad as well. But there's an element of surprise waiting around every single corner you take. And there's never a dull day. It's just an amazing place.
Chute à l'arrière du peloton, cycling podcast team car at the back of the pack, please.
That's Seb Piquet, the voice of Radio Tour at the Tour de France, to remind me to tell you that this episode is supported by Beer 52. And all our listeners in the UK can get a free case of 8 craft beers for just a £5.95 delivery cost by going to beer52.com/cycle. Beer 52 is a craft beer club with 100,000 members, and each month you get a case of beers delivered to your door. The selection is curated so you always get something different, and you can tailor your case to your tastes. So if you want refreshing lagers rather than rich dark beers, you can select that option. And if you want to cancel or pause your subscription at any time, you can do so. Now, last night after our Giro, I enjoyed a can of Bohemian Pilsner, a lager brewed in County Cork in Ireland. It was really fresh, very refreshing, and it even says on the can that it goes well with pizza. And pizza and a cold beer, absolutely perfect after a hard stage of our Giro. Anyway, if you want to try some of the beers for yourself, go to beer52.com/cycle and get your first case of 8 beers for just £5.95 delivery cost. That's beer52.com/cycle.
Well, we heard before the break from Graham Watson. I suppose we could call him legendary photographer of professional cycling over many years, and you know, given the lifespan of professional cyclists, I guess we could say he covered several eras of professional cycling, from the sort of, well, the late 70s, you know, and the Eno era into the Le Monde era, the Indurain era, all the way through the Armstrong years, right up to the present day, or the recent present. And as I said before we heard the interview, really was the lens, he was the lens through which we saw the sport, certainly back in the 80s. And fascinating to hear from him. Also interesting to hear him talk about his work as a photographer, and it got me thinking about how a photographer's job is different to a reporter's job. You know, inevitably, they're looking at it in an entirely a sort of visual way, aren't they?
Yeah, I think so, Rich. And at the Giro, well, as we've said, it's a feast for the eyes every day. And, you know, there almost seems to be, there's something quite deliberate about how beautiful the race looks. It's become part of the marketing pitch of the Giro. The hardest race in the most beautiful place. That is the slogan, isn't it? It is the slogan.
It is. The most beautiful race, the toughest race in the
something
most beautiful
along
place.
Those lines. Something along I mean, those lines.
If it's not worked on me terribly well there, if I can't remember it word for word,
yes,
but that's suggest,
is.
Isn't it?
But there's a care and an attention to detail, you know, just in terms of the branding of the race. And obviously, Italy is a fantastic country for bike racing and has incredible landscapes and incredibly varied landscapes that the organizers can use as their canvas. But yeah, you get the sense that it is a bigger priority. The aesthetics of the race are a bigger priority than they are, for example, at the Tour de France and the Vuelta a España.
And the detail at the Giro, I mean, the color pink, which we're going to move on to soon, is part of that, I think. But the, you know, I was looking at some photographs earlier by our colleague Simon Gill, some close-ups of the Giro trophy, for example. And the trophy sits there in the start village every day, doesn't it? It's a beautiful object, and the detail on that is beautiful too. The engraved names throughout, but the design of that is really stunning, I think. And all these little details add up to that visual feast that the Giro is, as you say.
What's the Giro trophy called, Daniel? The Trofea Senza?
Senza Fine.
Yeah,
basically the endless, the infinite trophy.
Right, because it's basically, for those who can't picture it, it's just almost like a sort of a circular ribbon cascading down, isn't it? And it's a beautiful golden gleaming thing, in contrast to the Tour de France trophy, which looks like a sort of I don't know, a cake stand that you leave on the side in the kitchen. I mean,
how many other trophies in cycling would you recognise? I can't actually think of any off the top of my head.
That's a good point.
No, it's a good point. Yeah. Yeah, but it's part of, I think, that visual appeal, that aesthetic sort of appeal that the Giro has. Before we go on to our pink package, I mean, what do you have a favourite Giro photograph? I was looking through some. I mean, you know, going back to the days of Coppi and Bartoli, we're going to talk about them in an episode coming up this week from Our Giro. Very hard to find a bad photograph of Coppi. You know, he was very photogenic with the hair and the sort of long limbs. But do you have any other? Do you have any favourite Giro photographs in particular?
Same era, Rich, or the back end of the Coppi era. One that stands out for me is the Fiorenzo Magni with on the Colle di San Luca above Bologna, where the Giro started last year. The arches running up alongside the road, and Magni biting, I think, bar tape or an inner tube wrapped around his handlebars. That's a famous one. A sort of favourite of mine has always been the one of Pantani winning in 1998, having beaten, you know, my Beniamino and Pavel Tonkov. A strange one for me to choose, but you know, it came at the end of what seemed like this endless duel. It seemed like it had been going on for weeks between Tonkov and Pantani. Every day they were going toe to toe in the mountains. In reality, it was only about 3 or 4 days, but to me it just seemed like this absolutely epic duel. And Pantani finally got the better of him on at the climb to Monte Campione, and his sort of pose, his celebration as he came over the finish line, well, it wasn't really a celebration, it was a sort of crucifix style pose on the bike, his arms held in a sign of a cross, I suppose, and you know, it was a sort of image full of kind of pathos, if anything. It was he didn't really look jubilant in any way. There was some sort of relief, but there was also some kind of maybe an omen or a sense of what Pantani had coming to him. It was almost a kind of religious image.
He looked like a martyr to the sport,
didn't
he?
He did. And you know, just also the kit, the fantastic Fila jersey, which, you know, there've been many different shades of pink jersey over the years. I think that one got it just about right. It was still very baggy back then. It looked as though Pantani had worn the pink jersey that he'd been, you know, given on the podium the previous night, which maybe wasn't the right size, but you know, there was a certain sort of romance even in that.
Yeah, I think my selection is also just from those years when the sport was really kind of taking a grip of me. It's a picture by Graham Watson, actually, and it's Andy Hampston on the start line, or in the starting house before the key time trial in the 1988 Giro. And to me at the time, it was just everything about the kind of the glamour of professional cycling, really. He stood in a sort of pose of concentration, hands on hips, tanned. He's wearing a Giro Maglia Rosa skin suit. So in contrast with the Tour de France jersey at that time, which seemed to be plastered in logos, sort of Gianni Savio style, this is a really, really simple, skin-tight fitting, shiny version, just with the Castelli logo on one side of the chest and La Gazzetta dello, and you can't quite read the sport because it goes round under his arm, but they're the only branding on the jersey. He's got his cloth cap, his casquette on his head, he's got his Oakley factory pilots, you know, big sunglasses, white, and
for which he was paid a nice bonus. We'll hear that in the episode tomorrow, actually. in Tuesday's episode, when Andy Hampson went on to win the Giro in 88, he won stage 12, and he was on a bonus for wearing those sunglasses, and he remembered to put them on just before the finish.
Well, he managed to get Graham to take a good publicity shot of him wearing them, because they're right across his face. The white and red lake shoes and white and red Nike socks, and even the bike, which now looks kind of old fashioned, I guess, with the upturned time trial handlebars, no triathlon style handlebars in those days. So just kind of effortless cool to it. And even the people in the background, you know, look Italian. There's a little glimpse of an Italian policeman with the epaulettes and almost a sort of sailor's type hat that some of the regional police seem to wear, and another guy in dark sunglasses. It looks kind of tense but also very relaxed, and I think there's something about that that sums up the Giro, really. It's a relaxed kind of tension, isn't it, for 3 weeks, the whole race, the whole thing.
I mean we mentioned their copy, Magni, Pantani, Hampson. It sort of raises the question about whether for a picture to be a great cycling picture, it needs great stars to be the subject. I mean, a picture I was going to mention doesn't feature any great stars. It's a picture again by Simon Gill at the near to the finish in Peschici a couple of years ago, down in the south of Italy, a climb up to the finish with some kind of gentle hairpin bends. And Valerio Conti, who rides for UAE Team Emirates, he was the strongest rider in the group, as he's been on several occasions, and he was kind of attacking and off the front ever so slightly when he just misjudged this corner and went down. And Simon's picture captures him sitting on the ground watching the other riders in the break ride past, and it's a brilliant picture. Yeah, the view out over the whole town and the bay with the riders in the middle of it, it's just a brilliantly composed picture, which he would have had a split second to take, obviously. So it's a great picture. We'll post that online for people to see or to be reminded of it. But it's a great picture, but it doesn't feature any great stars. So whether it qualifies as a great cycling picture is, I guess, a debate to be had.
Giro Dream Team with Ciro Scognamiglio.
David Miller, dear listeners, why? Well, one day in London, I was eating at a pret-a-manger near Trafalgar Square and near the window of the shop of the pret-a-manger. Suddenly, a vision. David Miller walking in the street. And he recognized me without any doubt. And we remember together that when in Milan, he won the last time trial of the Giro 1 year. I don't remember exactly when, but it's not important. And I had to interview him. We went together in a marvelous bar in Duomo Square, champagne, and David paid everything. So this is the reason, David, you will be in my team forever.
The Cycling Podcast at Our Giro d'Italia is supported by Science in Sport. Science in Sport, fueled by science.
Thank you very much to Science and Sport for supporting the Cycling Podcast. For 25% off all your Science and Sport products, go to scienceandsport.com and enter the code SISCP25. That's SISCP25. Just before the break there, we heard the latest pick in Ciro Scognamiglio's dream team. He's mainly gone for sprinters, hasn't he? Bit of a different... David Miller, what role did he fulfill?
The real revelation there is that, yet again, the barometer, the criteria that Ciro is using to select his team, David Miller included on the strength of the fact that he once, you know, was spotted Ciro in a pret-a-manger. I mean, you know, what would have happened
fair
if
enough.
It had been a McDonald's or a, I don't know.
Well, he wouldn't have been in the team, would he? Simple. Well,
I mean, David Miller, he could probably design the kit for the team, though, couldn't he? You know, again, cut down on team expenses.
Yeah, could be rider slash kit designer. I like the way you're thinking here, Lionel. Well, listen, speaking of kit and in sort of celebration of the colour of the Giro, pink, we put together a little package hung loosely on that idea of the colour pink and why that is important in giving the Giro its unique flavour, I suppose. So we're going to hear from a few people in this package, Lionel.
Well, yeah, we're going to hear from Sir Paul Smith, designer, cycling fan, and the man who created the 2013 Maglia Rosa for the Giro d'Italia. We're going to hear from Andy Storey, who runs the clothing retailers Prendas Ciclismo, who celebrate the history of the cycling jersey with a range of retro jerseys that they sell. And he's also the author of a very fine book called The Art of the Jersey. And I think, we kind of agreed that Italian jersey design is a cut above some of the others. I mean, in both directions, really, some of the best and some of the worst.
We're also going to hear in this package from Cassia Sinclair, an author who lives in London and a couple of years ago wrote a book called The Secret Lives of Colour. She's a sort of colour expert and really fascinating. I do like it when someone takes a subject that is very commonplace and so everyday that we don't really think about it anymore, but makes us think about it in a completely new way. Colours seem so obvious, don't they? A colour is just the colour. But
well, you're colourblind, aren't you?
I am colourblind.
You had no idea what she was talking about.
No.
You didn't even know what these were,
That's why, though, I'm so interested in the stories around the colours, the history, the associations and the meanings that we attach to colours, which is really what she's talking about. This was a Radio 4 Book of the Week in 2017. I remember hearing bits of that, and the stories about the colours are absolutely fascinating, and the stories around the colour pink are particularly fascinating because we think of it now, of course, as a feminine colour, but it hasn't always been the case, as we shall hear now.
It's quite nice for them to have complete ownership of a colour, and particularly a colour that is for, you know, whether we like it or not, in a sporting context, is seen as unusual. You know, it's part of the story. Pink is, because it's unusual, particularly in sport, it has its, it gives it this sort of stamp of individuality.
It's interesting with the three major tours, because they're all quite different in a way. I mean, arguably the most well-known around the world is the Tour de France, but the Giro, for me, has always been really enjoyable to go to, and I've been to a lot of the races and been privileged to go in the following cars and helicopters and all sorts, and you're going through those little villages, where the entire village has just stopped work, including the schools, including the convent with all the nuns outside, every bar's got the telly on. I know it happens in France and Spain as well, so it's not just Italy, but there's an affection for me personally to Italy, because I've had a home there for over 30-odd years.
There's a whole host of races that use yellow as the leader's jersey, isn't there? Whereas the Maglia Rosa, it certainly is iconic. I mean, you can't really... There's not much you can change, really. If you want the Maglia Rosa to look like a classic design, you have to sort of leave it alone, really.
I think pink is really is very unusual. I think for a start, just think about it. I think most people would say that pink is sort of a pretty major colour. It's one of the ones that, you know, if you're getting a box of crayons, you probably expect to find a pink in there. And we have its own, it has its own name and its own sort of colour category. But that's quite unusual. Really, pink is just pale red, and we don't assign that same importance to, say, a pale yellow or a pale green or even a pale blue. They're just pale blue or pale green, but pink is its own category. I think that's really interesting. Pink is really pale red, and therefore traditionally And up until about 100 years ago, it was associated with men because red was a sort of a hyper-masculine colour. It was very much associated with military uniforms and was sort of seen as very martial, and so was identified with men and with boys. And so pink became associated with men and with boys too. And that's both because it was kind of a pale red, but also because now, today, we are very used to having multiple sources of very stable colour. But, you know, before the mid-19th century, you'd expect colours to, you know, and dyes and pigments to fade quite a bit. And so officers' uniforms or military uniforms that started out as red might quickly fade to pink, but you'd still think of them, you'd still sort of categorise them as red. You'd understand that it's just faded red. You wouldn't sort of think of it as a different colour. So the boundaries of red were a little bit more elastic. But this changed around about, it begins changing around about between the First and the Second World War. So there's this quite famous article that I quote in my book, which is sort of a shopping guide, like a children's shopping guide from the New York Times in around about the era of the First World War. And a woman goes to a department store, the journalist goes to a department store and asks what you should get, little boys and little girls, and what colours you should go for them. And at that point, pink is for blue, pink is for boys, and blue is for girls. And the journalist makes some sort of slightly cheeky quip about the boys' outlook on life being sort of rosier than the girls, and girls thinking about their future in a man's world would be forced to feel blue. But that's sort of her sort of take on the traditional colours for genders. But of course, now that's completely switched around. My father, interestingly enough, who was born in 1925, he still thinks that, you know, pink, he will happily say, is his favourite colour, and he doesn't think about it as gendered at all. So he grew up at a time when the bonds between pink being for boys and blue being for girls were beginning to loosen. And then, you know, by the 50s and 60s, it's switched around.
I suppose the thing is, I was a bike rider from the age of 12 until 18, so not that long. And, you know, from my history, I had a bad crash and ended up being a fashion designer, but my love of cycling has never faltered, you know. So I think it was probably, you'll know how old I am now, but I think it was in the early 60s when I was still riding my bike, and the local cycle club had one or two lads that used to go to Belgium. I don't think they ever raced, but their you know, dream was to try and possibly race in Belgium or Flanders, you know, and they came back. I remember that. I mean, we all knew about the Tour de France, but none of us really knew about this race in Italy. And in fact, for years, I think I'm right in saying it was a very Italian affair for a long time, you know. And then I remember some guys saying about this thing called the Giro d'Italia, which is, I never even knew what Giro meant, you know. So it was quite interesting. And then I suppose wherever you could, which was hard, because I knew a lot about the Tour de France because of the we used to get L'Equipe, you know, the paper, the French paper, in a local news agency in Nottingham, but there was not too much about Italy, so it was just through snippets of the older members of the cycle club that had travelled a bit. I think it was probably more the 70s, yeah, when I opened my own little shop, and then I was a freelance stylist, and I was down in London a lot. And a lot of people I knew were still connected to cycling. And so I suppose in the mid-70s, is when you started to get to know a little bit more about the Giro, and of course the famous pink jersey, and the interesting about the pink jersey is that in a way it could only be the Italians that could, you know, come up with pink for a bloke, because for many years, especially at the beginning, you would imagine that was considered quite a feminine colour, but it's absolutely brilliant, and it looks so good on those guys because they're nearly always fantastically suntanned because they spend all their time outside. So it's a colour that works really well, actually.
Colour and what we project onto it are really inextricably linked. I don't think it would be possible for us to really separate out the two, because colours are such a lightning rod for both personal emotion, but also for all the cultural baggage and associations that we have. And these are constantly shifting over time as fashions change, as we fall in love with a particular sports team and begin to follow them very closely and begin to identify with them. We then might have very positive associations with that particular colour, but we might also then have negative associations about the jerseys worn by their chief rivals and that colour. And I think that is what is so wonderful about colour.
When I did the my one, we did a few some quite a lot of promotion on it in my showroom in Milan and here in London, and the Giro guys very kindly lent me some of the jerseys for the press conference, and some of those early ones were in a fabric called rayon. And they had like little buttons at the top and a collar and the pockets at the front and the pockets at the back, you know, for food. And they were fantastic. In my heart, I still love those the best, because the ones that we use now are very practical and fantastic and work really well in terms of breathing and UV filters and practicality and... but those early rayon ones, and then the ones before that, the woolen ones, genius to look at, bloody awful to wear, because if you got soaking wet, the water stayed with you and they just got heavier and heavier for hours. I mean, there's some amazing jerseys from that era, you know, from the late 60s, and people like Giamondi, you know, he wonderful pictures of him wearing those early jerseys. Amazing. I mean, it's a hard one to do as a designer, because you haven't got a lot of scope, really, because there's so much you have to... obviously, it has to be pink. and also, you have to respect the sponsors. So you've got... Balocco, the biscuit people, the Gazzetta dello Sport, the SMS Santini, the makers of the actual jersey. So you have to respect those, and obviously you have to respect the colour. So I decided that, look, it's fantastic anyway, so just what I called nudge it. Don't try and shove it into something too different. So obviously I'm quite famous for my use of stripes, and so just on one sleeve, the rib on one of the short sleeves is got my famous what we call multi-stripe, but it's very subtle. It's just and it's just on one cuff, one little rib, and then I'm quite the other thing I'm quite well known for is I still use paper and pencil quite a lot, and I've always got a notebook in my pocket. So on the right hand side of the jersey at the side is just a little not very good drawing of a guy on a bike, and then Paul Smith written underneath it, and that's on the mesh bit at the side, and then at the back there's Paul Smith written on it, but sort of only just on it, so it's sort of got half of the Paul and half of the Smith on it. So it's very subtle what I did, but actually it was obviously the privilege for me as well was being able to put Paul Smith on the neck. So, you know, when you get those photos at the end of each stage, and the whoever's wearing the famous jersey, you've got your name there. It's like, wow, quite proud, to say the least, you know, very proud.
The things that linked little boys and pink and little girls and blue started to become a bit fuzzier. So military uniforms are no longer red or even very bright colours. They become khaki around this time. So, you know, you lose that kind of very strong association between men and red. And, you know, at the same time, Britain's power is waning across the world stage. And so the kind of very strong British association with red coats and with pink begins to wane too. You also get the same thing happening on the other side, where, you know, one of the reasons why blue had been associated with little girls is because of the Virgin Mary. She was kind of seen as the, you know, in the Western world, the Western Christian world, as the epitome of what a woman should be or should aspire to be. And she had traditionally been depicted in the blue pigment ultramarine in paintings. And, you know, you also, that begins to break down as society becomes, you know, less religious overall. I think it's a really beautiful colour, but then I think I have quite complicated feelings towards it as a girl, because, you know, as a child of the 80s, I was pretty much only allowed to wear pink until I was able to buy my own clothes. And therefore I refused to wear pink for about, you know, for quite a long time. And now I'm beginning to allow it back into my wardrobe. But I think for girls and women who've had pink kind of shoved down their throats for their entire lives, it can, you know, it can seem quite a complicated colour.
Yeah, I mean, Mark, I remember him coming up to me afterwards, absolutely worn out, and he said, I did that for you.
It's Cavendish versus Gosford. Lionel's involved. What a finish! Oh. And Cavendish is the leader of the Giro. Amazing stuff.
But I want this so bad. My good friend Paul Smith is here. He did the jersey. I promised him I'd win the jersey the first time.
And it was I remember David Miller saying it. Bloody hell, that was such a strong first stage down in Naples. And Mark, I think really, thank you, Mark, because he really, really worked hard to be on the podium wearing the Paul Smith jersey. And for me, obviously, it was goosebump time. It was really touching because he did work hard, and it was quite a dangerous race with, I think, one of the final corners was a very tight bend. And I remember David saying, wow, that was hairy, that was. And then, of course, I'd met Nibali a few times, and what a charming man he is, and a really humble guy, very much of the man from the village he came from. And his parents, I met his parents, and you know, all the locals in his village are such fans. And so seeing him, Italian, in a Paul Smith design, winning it, wow, I mean, that was fantastic. And of course, the other thing was the Pope blessed it. I don't know whether that's a normal thing every year, but I mean, there's this wonderful picture they sent me, Gazzetta dello Sport sent me, with the picture of the Pope blessing the Paul Smith jersey. I mean, wow, you can't get much higher than that, can you? And one of my standout stages was one that obviously I didn't see because I was 3 years old, but was a Fausto Coppi. And of course he wore for years the pale blue Bianchi jersey, the very simple pale blue jersey with the white band with Bianchi written on it. I mean, that's such an elegant jersey. And then also going back to Gimondi, the pale blue Salvarani jersey that he wore in the 60s as well. I mean, and again, if you look online and look him up, because I met Giamondi before he passed away, I think it was last year, and really good looking guy. So him in that pale blue jersey with just a simple one name across the front. And the other one I loved was the red and white, the FAMA, you know, the F-A-E-M-A, that's the famous coffee machine that was really popular in the 60s and very, looked like the coffee machine looked like some sort of American Cadillac, you know, and that jersey was wonderful. I think Merckx used that one.
So my name's Andy Story. I work at Prenda Ciclismo. I've been here for too long. Basically, the company was formed 23 years ago by a guy called Mick Tarrant, and I took it over about 3 years ago after having worked here for sort of 16 years, I think. Yeah. When we first started the sort of retro jersey program, it wasn't really a program. It was a single jersey. It was the Peugeot jersey. And it all started because Mick was at the Santini ballroom, and they have loads of pictures of all the riders that they've clothed over the years, like Le Monde. And the case in point, Phil Anderson and Sean Yates were captioned incorrectly on one of the photos. They were the wrong way around. So, and as one of them was wearing a Peugeot jersey, Mick sort of casually asked if they could make 100 or so for us. The rest is history, really. We started from having the Peugeot jersey to having probably around 20 retro jerseys at once. It also, and of course, when, you know, the sort of, we used to sell a huge variety of current protein kits, you know, so whether it was Once or Mappe or, but obviously the demand for protein kits has fallen over the years. So the sort of retro program sort of, replace that really with teams from the past. Vittorio Gianni probably was, you know, one of the first. Although they're not actually around as a name anymore. It was them that sort of morphed into Castelli. Obviously Castelli are still about. There's Moa and Nalini. They used to make a huge number of the protein kits, both for the pro riders and for resale. Santini, which is obviously one of our bigger suppliers. Sportful is another one. Probably the Mappe team sort of put them on the map, really. Traditionally, Italian made jerseys have always been on the smaller side of things. That's still reasonably true to this day. If you say compare a brand that's for the US or UK market, generally speaking, Italian jerseys tend to be one size different. But then, of course, you have, you know, well, it's us. We're a UK company, obviously, but we're having items made in Italy. So everybody's supply chain, it's a global supply chain now. So, the items, there might be an Italian company, and they might have nothing made in Italy now. Whereas, you know, there might be the other way around, whereas you have, say, yeah, I mean, obviously, Rafa have, you know, items made in Italy, as do we. So, the supply chain is very different now. It probably stems back from when I first started cycling. It was like the late 80s, and it was really difficult to sort of assemble a set of kit, you know, which matched. It sounds ridiculous saying it now. You know, you can assemble a great-looking kit, you know, in a matter of probably a quarter of an hour on the internet, and it's with you the next day. It was, you know, to get, say, a set of kit that looked great, that also washed reasonably well, and, you know, it was a major achievement to sort of have, you know, jersey, shorts, socks, mitts, cap. I mean, if you managed to sort of have the complete set, you know, it was a miracle. So I suppose coming from a mountain biking background, you know, the aesthetics of road racing were completely different. Obviously, mountain biking was very American-led, whereas the sort of road side of things, you know, you might get, say, that we used to obviously have the built race, you know, come to Bournemouth most years, and you'd have, say, like the Z team would turn up, you know, and they all look just so
so great, you know, I appreciate there's a French team, but you know what I'm saying. It was the sort of the continental aspect of the team, you know. They just all looked, they all looked a million bucks, really.
But the one I wanted to really talk about was because of my, one of the first memories I've got about cycling was this word, and I use it very carefully when I'm saying this. There was this word that the older members of the cycle club used to say, and it was called, it was actually either one word or two words. One was copy and one was Fausto copy. And as a young man who, my parents never traveled abroad, we were a very humble family, we never spoke any languages. So when there was this word Fausto copy, and then later on, Jacques Anquetil, I never knew really what they were. And then years later, of course, realized, not that many years later, but then I realized that Fausto Coppi was this absolutely amazing bike rider. And then I remember reading about 1949, stage 17, from Cunha to Pinerolo. And, you know, Coppi and the Bartelli thing, which then I understood more because of seeing these cafes in Tuscany, you know, taking 12 minutes out of Bartelli over five mountains and then going on to win the Giro and then winning the Tour the same year, being the first person to win the double, you know, 1949, stage 17. I mean, absolutely genius.
Ultimately, you know, the men and women of the professional peloton are billboards, you know. So sometimes, you know, if you do something a little bit different and it creates a bit of discussion, then they've done their job, haven't they, really?
Well, we heard there a bit of a rundown of some of the classic Italian cycling jerseys from history. Have you got a favourite, each of you?
Bianchi.
Obvious.
Every time.
Yeah. It's, to you, that's a sort of deep purple, isn't it, colour, rather than...
It's brown, isn't it? No, blue is not a colour I struggle with, and it's a kind of shade of blue, isn't it? It's on the spectrum of blue. But, you know, it's funny how... I've mentioned copy a few times, and although we only really... no copy in black and white, the kit still looks fantastic somehow, and we know now obviously what color it was. And
yeah, it looked great on Jan Ulrich as well, didn't it? Really,
it did look great on Jan Ulrich, really did. Yeah
Daniel,
Well the obvious answer would be Mappe. I mean generally that era, most people would think that the jerseys from the late 90s were an absolute dog's dinner, but I actually loved them. Even, you know, Polti were a rival team of Mappe, with the sort of the cartoons, plume of, you know, steam coming out of an iron, a Polti iron. I thought that was fantastic. A wonderful combination that looked like a sort of, what were those penny sweets called? Fruit salads? Yeah, I enjoyed that. And I mean, it's worth considering as well that the pink jersey, which I do consider to be the most attractive of the and the most iconic of the leaders' jerseys in the Grand Tour, could have been a different colour, because of course it was inspired by is pink because La Gazzetta dello Sport, the paper that started the Giro d'Italia, is printed on pink paper. But, you know, there was a time when La Gazzetta, before the Giro started, when La Gazzetta was pink, was printed on green paper. Yeah. And why they chose pink, why it ended up being on pink paper, there are all sorts of stories and theories about that, including the fact they'd simply run out of white or they'd run out of green.
Interesting. Well, the debate over which is the best Italian cycling jersey of all time will be definitively settled by social media. You know, any kind of controversial subject can easily be sorted out on Twitter, can't it? The Coppa Italia of cycling jerseys kicks off. It's a World Cup style competition, a series of groups of four jerseys for people to vote for. Top two in each group will go through to the knockout stages. The first group will be online now as you're listening to this. There's a very obvious group of death with some real big guns in there. Please don't vote for Mapai.
Shall we leave it there, chaps? I'd like to say a word for Lamprey as well. I was like the Fondriest era Lamprey kit. I thought that was cool.
Oh, you mean the Tonkov era?
Lamprey Tonkov kit. Era, okay.
Well, yeah, no, actually, Tonkov was Panari and then, yeah, Lamprey later. Anyway. Yeah.
Anyway, that's all for tonight. Thank you very much, Lionel. What's coming up tomorrow, Lionel?
Well, tomorrow is the first part of your interview with Andy Hampston, the American who won the Giro in 1988. I think we're splitting this conversation into two halves and looking at the 1985 Giro first.
Before we go tonight, a few thank yous to friends of the podcast. Thanks very much, everybody who's signed up as a friend of the podcast. And for me, big thanks to Ian Marchant, Steve Eastow Waring, Patrick Slater, Dominic Wilson, Mark Aykroyd, and Liz Riley.
And thank you to Oliver Stevens, Shane Coughlin, Stephen Palmer, Paul Swift, and Simon Smith.
And from me to Peter Lichtenstein Jurgensen, Matthew Moore, Margaret Elderfield, Andy Conroy, James Bauman, Sean Smith, and Dina Entercott.
Des yeux qui font baisser les miens, un rire qui se perd sur sa bouche. Voilà le portrait sans retouche de l'homme auquel j'appartiens. Quand il me prend dans ses bras, il me parle tout bas, je vois la vie en rose. Il me dit des mots d'amour, des mots de tous les jours, et ça me fait quelque chose. Il est entré dans mon cœur une part de bonheur dont je connais la cause. C'est lui pour moi, moi pour lui dans la vie. Il me l'a dit, l'a juré pour la vie. Et dès que je l'aperçois, alors je sens en moi mon cœur qui bat. Des nuits d'amour à plus finir, un grand bonheur qui prend sa place, des ennuis, des chagrins s'effacent, heureux à en mourir. Quand il me prend dans ses bras, il me parle tout bas, je vois la vie en rose. Il me dit des mots d'amour, des mots de tous les jours, et ça me fait quelque chose. Il est entré dans mon cœur une part de bonheur dont je connais la cause. C'est lui pour moi, moi pour lui dans la vie. Il me l'a dit, l'a juré pour la vie. L'aperçoit, alors je sens en moi mon cœur qui bat. La 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 la. La vie en rose, that's a song by Edith Piaf. It was actually written, I think, by a guy called Jean Constantin, if I'm right. Anyways, La Vie en Rose, Life in Pink, that's what the Giro leader's life is about. I don't know who's in pink in our Giro at the moment, but anyways, this was La Vie en Rose by Edith Piaf, of course, probably the most famous French singer ever. I hope you liked it, and looking forward to another song for our Giro. Cheers, bye.